Hi, I'm Robert Connolly. I'm here at Toronto with my film Blueback, starring Ryder Mitchell, Mia Wasikowska, and Eric Banner. Now, Blueback's based on one of Australia's greatest novellas about the ocean, and I fell in love with it the minute I read it. It takes you as a reader, and now as a film, as an audience, beneath the ocean. Such a huge amount of the film is set in the most extraordinary reefs and marine ecosystems that, you know, I had this gift to go and film in. But ultimately, I think it's a timely film about saving the oceans. You know, it's an optimistic environmental fable, and one that I think is just so relevant right now. You know, it's such a big question for us all. How do we preserve and save our oceans? Incredible to make a film set beneath the ocean, but very challenging. We had to train the actors to free dive, to scuba dive. I didn't want to use stunt performers. I wanted the actors down there, deep in the water. And we had to work out how to film it. I have incredible cinematographers, Andy Comis, one of Australia's greatest, and Rick Rafici, actually, who people would know from his work on things like the Blue Planet series with David Attenborough, an amazing underwater cinematographer. So, you know, I knew for an audience, I kind of almost had to take the audience there. So I had to take the cameras and the actors as deep into the ocean as I could in the most remote part of Australia. Challenging as that was, it's also incredibly rewarding. It's an amazing gift in my career to make a film like this, to actually go and see this amazing part of the world and to take an audience there. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to take people from all over the world to this remote, beautiful reef system. I think the most profound sequences in the film to capture were the ones deep in the cave system where Blueback lives. I think it's the magic of that world, shafts of light. It's a crater, actually, that, you know, deep beneath the water, and that a coral reef has formed over, and, you know, and the mystery and the magic of a young girl diving down and looking into this cave system at the extent of where, you know, this is not on scuba, this is just with a breath of air, and looking in there and this fish emerging. But logistically, you know, you're working with an animatronic puppet for the fish, you're working with an incredible cave system, you're working with an actor, you know, Ilse in her first film, someone you've trained to dive down there, but she's, you know, it's new territory for her to be swimming that deep. All these different pieces coming together. We've got drones, shark mitigation drones, checking for sharks before Ilse swam down there. So all of these things put together kind of created like a challenge. But I believe that films somehow capture in their DNA the way you've made them. If they're adventurous, the film will feel adventurous to an audience. So I think the way we made it is something audiences will feel. I mean, I love the magic of practical cinema. I think we live in a world where you can watch a film now that's 80% VFX and CGI. And I have always found, I mean, I think of my childhood, E.T. and Yoda and even, interestingly, the whole Jurassic Park franchise. You know, I heard one of the special effects guys saying that across the series, they've increasingly used more animatronics. I think it's because audiences can feel the artificiality of some VFX. And I know Mia Wasikowska, when she swam with this incredible puppet of Blueback, came out of the water and turned to me and said, "I forgot that it was a puppet, an animatronic puppet." And I think you're looking for the performance beats as well. But also it's fun. You know, Creature Tech, a Melbourne-based company, they're known for walking with dinosaurs and for making, you know, massive, you know, life-size Tyrannosaurus Rexes. And when I approached them and said, "Could you help me build a blue groper?" they were up for it. I think also the way we move through the water and the pressure that water exerts, very hard to get right in VFX. If you look at a lot of films, even massive, massive studio films, it's very hard to get right.
The lack of weight.
It really is. It's a lack of the pressure and the weight of the water. So having the actors and our animatronic fish in real-world environments swimming together, I think gives it a real kind of, I think for the audience, it feels more visceral and truthful. Yeah, one of the most incredible things with a story like this is to work with these amazing, you know, young actors. It is a deeply personal, humanist story about a young woman who falls in love with the ocean and has a journey to become a world-renowned marine biologist, and her mother, who taught her about the ocean. I think those big, universal, personal stories are so important, and they kind of speak to us all, you know. How do you become the person you are and live your best, most fulfilling life? And, you know, I was delighted that Radha Mitchell, playing the mother, and Ilse Fogg were able to get that, the dynamic of that, the conflict, the love, the passion that it is to have a really inspiring mother. I couldn't believe, you know, on this film that I got to work with Eric Banner again. We'd done the film The Dry. I'd produced Romulus, my father, you know, a very, very close friend. And when I gave him the script and he loved the role, I was delighted, because he is one of our great actors. He brings comedy and humanity and insight into this character of a kind of rogue abalone fisherman at the bottom of the world. And it was fun, too, to work with Eric on a character role. You know, in The Dry, it's more that leading man role that we've come to know in his exceptional work. But to see him really embrace this character and have fun with it and a playful kind of adventure with it was great. You know, I just think he's, you know, one of our most delightful actors, and directing him is a joy. Amazing. Yeah, storytelling has been in my bones since my father used to take me into the bush, and we'd sit around the campfire and he'd tell me stories as a little 4, 5, 6, 7 year old. And I think that, you know, we are storytellers. We're all storytellers. There's not one person that I could meet here at Toronto that I couldn't sit down with and ask them about themselves, and they would tell me a story about themselves. Some people have to be pushed, some are shyer, some are more audacious, much like filmmakers. So I think as a society and as a community, when we share stories, it's quite profound. It has the capacity to affect change. It has the potential to show untold stories to the world, things that have gone omitted. We're seeing that with the incredible First Nations program here at TIFF, which I think is absolutely stunning. And I think with Blueback, it has the chance to inspire something. You know, I believe in the Jacques Cousteau quote, you know, if you can make people fall in love with something, they will care for it. Blueback is trying to tell a story that will make you, the audience, fall in love with the ocean. It's a film trying to tell a story to inspire activism. But most importantly, and it's a big push in the environmental movement, it's optimistic. You know, it says if we change our ways, we can affect the environment, we can have a profound effect. And so I love all of that, and really kind of deep in my DNA, you know, and the career and the life I've led, is this kind of belief that storytelling is kind of critical and a critical part of all of our experiences of kind of living in this era. The filmmaker that's had the biggest influence on me is the Australian director Peter Weir. I saw his films when I was younger. As a school group, we were taken to see Gallipoli, Picnic at Hanging Rock. His film The Year of Living Dangerously really impacted on me with my film Balibo, which played here at TIFF with Oscar Isaac and Anthony LaPaglia. And then beyond that, watching his storytelling in the United States, you know, The Truman Show and Witness. I think he's a humanist storyteller. I think what I like about him, it's not showy. It's not demonstrative. It's not showing off his virtuosic filmmaking skill, which is he clearly has. It's more about telling deeply humanist stories. It's almost like, as a filmmaker, he applies the microscope to the human condition in every film, and I love that. An inspiration, and continues to be, and I really would love to see him do more work. Yeah, my own kind of approach to directing's changed. I think my very first film, The Bank, which played here in the Discovery section in 2001, 21 years ago, and I'm very proud of that film, but I think as a director my work was more it was more strategic and planned. You know, it kind of had a precision to it. I think my brain, I was a chess playing kid, you know, I had a scientific brain. It kind of has a more of a formal nature. And I think my journey has been to try and break away from that and loosen myself up so that as a director I can feel like I'm I'm capturing real life unfolding in front of the camera, so that I can try and somehow set up a situation and get it happening and get actors performing and get their camera to kind of feel like it's almost catching up with something truthful and real. That's been my biggest journey. And I think, you know, when I watch a lot of films, I think for a lot of audiences, it's that sense of you come out of the cinema and you forgot you're in the cinema. You've been in there for 2 hours, you forgot. You just got lost in it. And I think the great filmmakers find ways to make you kind of forget the artificiality of what it is. These are actors reading dialogue or performing dialogue that someone else has written in an artificial environment that's been designed. So how do you transcend that? That for me is, and I think audiences demand it, particularly younger audiences. My kids, 18, 20, they are so suspicious of things that are fake. They've been sold stuff to, they've been manipulated since they were little. They want things to be truthful. And I think that's the journey. That's the journey for me as a director. The big screen is my passion. You know, I've directed for the small screen and had some great adventures doing that. But the big screen, I think it goes back to that idea of storytelling and who you want to tell a story to and the collective audience that I love in a cinema. You know, the fact that we're having a premiere with 1,000 people in an incredible cinema and showing this film to them and that they're sharing the experience of watching it is just so profoundly important to me. And it's why I became a filmmaker. The challenge then, as a director, is how do you make it different to television? How do you make it bigger? So we're now looking at, you know, Blueback, which is filmed on large format lenses, a new Panavision camera system. We've got a big, massive orchestral score. The sound design team I work with have done a big Dolby Atmosphere sound design. Like, everything I have done with Blueback is to make it feel like you have to see it in the cinema. That is the way to see it. It's the best way to see it. You'll have the most emotional response to it in the cinema. And that then kind of combines with my own agenda to try and impact on people. And I think you get people collectively together. They go out afterwards, they talk about it, they are inspired by it. But, you know, I'm not naive about it. I think it's a challenge for filmmakers. We have to make things different. We have to really embrace. There's no point trying to make middle-of-the-road stuff now. There's no place for it.